This is Mieghan Bruce, and she's going to be presenting today on her work, her post-doc work with Mammoth. And I will hand over to her and explain all the rest, and have time for questions and answers afterwards.
Okay, thank you very much for coming here. I don't know if you know, well, some of you know a lot about Mammoth. Basically, it's a project that's looking at metrics and methods linking agriculture and nutrition and health outcomes. And so I was fortunate to have a one-year fellowship with Amana, and I was interested in to see whether we could use system dynamics as a methodology for looking at the different pathways between agriculture and food systems, and then human health and nutrition. And obviously, as a vet, my focus is on animal health interventions, so that's what I'll be looking at today. So, looking at the links between animal health and child nutrition, and the fieldwork has been in Tanzania. So, as we're looking at methods and metrics, really trying to focus on the method side of it, the results are bonus, but I would really like some feedback on how you think that. I've sort of looked at the different pathways, and if you've got any ideas about how to sort of improve the model, that would be great. And maybe how to zoom inside into the results that we're getting, because they're a little skewed, let's say. So just an outline of the presentation today. So just a background about the problem, agriculture and nutrition. Looking at a little bit about system dynamics, just to discuss those methodology. The methods actually of the study itself. Some of the results are quite preliminary and the conclusions. Looking a little at the limitations of the study, both data limitations as well as the limitations of the model, how I put it together, and then what I'd like to do next. So, background. As you're probably very well aware, there's an inextricable link between food systems and human health, which includes nutrition. The agricultural interventions have quite a good potential for improving nutrition within households. So if you improve the farming practices on a farm, hopefully it helps to improve the nutrition of the people living on the farm or are linked to that farm. And I'm particularly interested in the children within that farming family. Farm level link, or household level link, however you like to describe it, is quite hard to document. You really need quite specific data. And there was a review which found that the evidence of the impact of agricultural programs on child agri-metric measurements or micronutrient status is quite inconclusive. And they found that a lot of this is just because the data may not have been analysed in the correct way, so we're really looking at ways that we can, methodology we can use, or metrics that we can use as indicators for looking at the links between agriculture and health and nutrition. So we need a better understanding of the farm level pathways between agriculture and nutrition within the farming family. So, the pathways between agriculture and nutrition. How is own production associated with farm, household, food access, diet quality, and nutrition outcomes? So there's lots and lots of frameworks and pathway models. And so basically we can divide it into four broad pathways. Food prices, so this is the broader food environment that a household exists within. Income from agriculture, actually on the farm, or within the household. And consumption of what's actually produced on the farm, and some of the social cultural factors that looking at household dynamics, and a big one is gender. But all of these pathways interlinked, so we get a bit of a spaghetti junction. So the rationale for, well, sorry, I didn't explain, one of the interventions we're looking at is to do with poultry farming, or poultry management within family poultry. One of them is Newcastle disease vaccine. So the rationale for looking at poultry, particularly in small holding households or poor rural households, is that many will keep poultry. They provide food, small cash income, and they can strengthen social capital. They can use in a time of shock. So if suddenly someone becomes ill, they can sell some of their poultry to pay for their healthcare. And one of the key characteristics of family poultry is that there's very low inputs. So basically they're scavenging systems. They will try and find food around the household, go in and take pickings from in the crop. And a lot of the time, once the crop's being harvested, you'll find chickens around where the crop's being stored, and that they'll take pickings off the ground. You can use table scraps or household waste to feed poultry as well. So in terms of actual inputs, it's very low. And one of the other key factors is that women and children tend to be responsible for small numbers of poultry. When you get sort of more commercial flocks, obviously it tends to be managed a bit more as a business rather than as sort of a household cash flow. And that accords really well with a focus on gender within agricultural development. Newcastle disease, which is one of the focuses of this project, causes really high mortality, so can be up to 100% in naive populations. And because poultry turnover is really high, we get a lot of predation, new birds being born all the time. So level of immunity can wane really quickly within a village. And so if they haven't been exposed to low levels of the virus for a while, it can come in and pretty much wipe out the whole population. So it can be really devastating for families and for whole villages. So the idea is if we can decrease the mortality associated with Newcastle disease, then we have lower mortality rates, flock size can increase, or we can actually sell more to increase in income within a family, farming family, or they can actually consume the birds in the house. Also, we've increased the number of hens, we have more eggs, so there's potential for children and mothers to be able to consume eggs, which is not done very often, particularly in the area that we're working in. Poultry systems are quite complex. They're obviously part of a broader small holding situation where you've got some crops, maybe other livestock, and they also have to interact with other priorities within the family. So even if you have more birds, they might be kept as an asset store rather than for consumption, so that they can be used at the start of the school year, to buy school uniform, to buy books, or if someone's ill, they can be used for health care. And also within a poultry flock itself, it's quite a dynamic environment, and one component of a flock can affect the other component. For instance, if you increase numbers of birds, then you need to increase the amount of food available for that number of birds. And so when there's not enough food around, so the food resource base, which they call the scavenging resource base for that particular village, if that's not also increased by improving some supplementary feeding or giving more of the table scraps to birds, then of course you're just going to get mortality due to undernutrition of the chickens. So we've got to look at sort of a broader poultry system as well as its interaction with other parts of the food system. So then I just wanted to describe a little bit what system dynamics as a methodology is. I know Georgina knows. I'm not sure if anyone else has had much exposure. So basically, it's a methodology and a mathematical modelling technique for framing, understanding, and discussing complexities and problems. So this is basically how I like to sort of describe system dynamics linking agriculture, and in my office bias is the livestock production systems, to nutrition outcomes. So with livestock production, then it can be used for food, income, and asset store. And that should also have some social capital in there, looking at the livelihoods framework. And then that feeds into household dynamics and decision making. And within that, we have individual child nutrition outcomes within that family. So the decisions made at household level obviously affect what happens to the child within that household. But then looking at the household, we have labour and animal husbandry, which then feeds back into how that livestock production system functions. That's just very sort of brief overview of sort of a systems framework for linking livestock and livestock food systems with human health and nutrition. So there's four main objectives to a system dynamics approach. It helps us to examine the system as a whole. So we're looking at agriculture and health as one big system. And its constituent parts, we can look at just livestock, we can look at just child nutrition, we can look at child nutrition within a broader family dynamic, as well as the interactions between the two different or three different components. It helps us to provide a visual, or as a lot of people sort of draw conceptual frameworks, but it's sort of a way of drawing a conceptual framework as a system, so how it all interlinks. We can look at backflows, interlinking, and what they call feedback loops. So, for instance, within a population model for chicken, if you have more hens, they lay more eggs. If you have more eggs, then you can have more chickens, and then, so that's sort of a positive feedback, all else being equal. Of course, you need to feed those chickens, as I described before. Then we can have different ways of looking at sort of rebalancing the system. And it's also really good to be able to get a group together and say, this is our problem, map it out. And people can map different things, and it helps everyone to get an understanding from a different perspective. So it's really good when you're looking at what we call interdisciplinary problems. So we're looking at health, environmental problems in this, as well as farming systems. So we're getting people from different areas, as well as we actually did some group work with the people participating as so the farmers themselves, which helped us to develop the model. And then once we've sort of got a conceptualization, we can use the framework to understand the dynamic feedbacks. So as I was describing before, with not just looking at population, we would have this ever spiraling population out of control. So then we've got to look at its interlinking with other parts of the system and how that helps to sort of rebalance. And the idea is that we can use it to allow decision makers to evaluate the potential of certain outcomes. So within these models, we can simulate sort of what if scenarios. We can say, what if we vaccinate? What if we don't vaccinate? What happens if we decide to have a new market for chickens that then people can sell their chickens for more? What would the potential be for how that would affect the overall system? So it's obviously an iterative process. We developed a concept, we develop a model, we try and run the model, realise there's something that's not quite working, go back to the concept, try and reevaluate the model. So it's a forever project, let's say. So we identify the problem. In this case, the effect of there is the potential for agriculture interventions to improve health and nutrition, but a lot of the time it doesn't actually work as we perceive it to be. So that's our problem identification in this system. So we conceptualised the model, which we used in this case with focus group discussions and workshops. And once we conceptualised the model, then we developed it within system dynamics software, helping to quantify the model. Then we can simulate different scenarios and help to validate the model a little bit using some of the data. And then the biggest hopeful use is that we can use this to then help to communicate the results to design better food system interventions and programs and policies within the area. One of the things about the system is that we can't include everything, so we need to have some model boundaries, and within that we have different elements, which are sort of the variables which affect how the model is functioning or how the system is functioning. So there's usually sort sort of three ways to describe elements within the system. You have endogenous, which are all the potentially important ones, which influence other parts of the system and are also influenced by other parts of the system. So it's kind of a bi-directional flow. So they're the endogenous ones. We also have exogenous variables or elements. So they're all the ones that potentially affect the system but are not necessarily affected by the system. So for instance, within an agricultural system, you would say probably rainfall in a short-term scenario, because obviously rainfall affects yields, but yields don't necessarily affect rainfall, unless we're talking about long climatic cycles, but that's beyond the scope of my model. And then we have ones which are actually omitted. So I've omitted quite a few in this sort of basic model for a couple of reasons. One, we don't have the data to have them there. And also because I wanted to try and start small and then hopefully sort of build on it. So there's sort of a couple of functions within system dynamics methodology. You have stocks and flows. So a stock is an element that accumulates or depletes over time. So basically, it's like a bath. So you pour water in, or you can pull the plug out, and it will go up and down over time. And a flow is the amount of water going in and the amount of water going out. And it's usually described like that. So the stock is the bath, and the flow in is your bucket of water. And the other, one of the other main elements or key elements of the system dynamics model is the feedback loops. So you can have reinforcing links, which I was talking about, population explosions, and you can have negative links or loops, which is sort of called rebalancing. So in this case, your rebalancing would be the outflow going to sales or home consumption will help to rebalance the size of your population within the chicken flock. So that's sort of a little way of describing that. You've got eggs and chickens, as I was describing before. We've got chickens laying eggs, and then they hatch, which then goes into birds. And within this, so that's your population explosion, because there's no outflows, as you can see. You would want to have mortality rates, sales, gifting, home consumption, to try and rebalance that population. So the R there, that little loopy bit in the middle, the R one is sort of to demonstrate that that's a reinforcing loop. So these are the, just discuss a little bit methods of the actual study that we did. It's part of a broader project which is called Strengthening Food and Nutrition Security through Family Poultry and Crop Integration in Tanzania and Zambia. So I was working in Zambia, I mean Tanzania, 50-50 chance there. Child stunting in Tanzania is 42%, so it's very high, and the area that we're working in is thought to be much higher than that. And so the aim of the project, which is led by the University of Sydney in Australia, and it's funded through a government research grant, ACR. The aim of the project is to reduce childhood undernutrition by analysing testing opportunities to improve poultry and crop integration and efficiency within those systems, whilst enhancing the key role women play. So that's why the focus of this project has been on poultry, because it's linked to women's ability to make decisions of what happens to poultry. So it's a randomised control trial, and one of the components is Newcastle disease vaccine. So they had, in the ward where I'm working, there are four villages. So they started vaccine in two villages, and then a year later started vaccine in the other two villages. So we've got some data work which we can compare vaccinated villages with unvaccinated villages. It's not perfect because even though there's a village border, I mean, of course, chickens are going to cross back and forth. So, yeah, I mean, and there's some sort of diffusion of some of the effects of the integration of the intervention. And also the non-intervention villages got a bit upset that they weren't being vaccinated, so the vaccine in the non-vaccinated villages started a little early, so there's sort of 10 months lag between the two. So the study area, so this is a map of Tanzania, which some of you would know very well. So Dodoma is the capital, Dar es Salaam is usually where most people go, that's where it happens. The capital is an administrative capital, so people go there basically for parliament sitting, which affects this village or the ward where this study is, because it's quite close to Dodoma. So when the parliament's sitting, everybody wants to eat chicken, so there's more ability to sell and at higher rates. So the income is much better there. So just to have a look a little further, we've got the dome sitting here. It's about 80 kilometres in the dry season. In the wet season, we're going to go up through Manioni and then back around because the villages are flooded. The rivers are flooded. And even within the ward itself, I'll show you in the next picture. We developed this map because the administrative map has these villages as even size, but as you can see, Ikasi, which is the top village near the lake, is actually quite a bit bigger in terms of geographical size, than the other ones. And this here is the river. So when it rains, you have to wade across from Sanza village to Chichere. So it kind of can be a little bit of a natural barrier for the chicken Newcastle disease, but only in certain parts of the year. And when there's a drought, it doesn't have any effect at all. So this particular, I use data from Chichere and Sanza villages, but it actually, for the chicken model, I started using results from the other two villages as well, just to see if we have more data points that we can get the data to make more sense. So what I've done is a subset of a larger study. So the broader study includes Tanzania and Zambia. There's three study sites within Tanzania itself. And so I'm focusing just on one study site. And within that ward, there's four villages, and I've collected or using data from two villages within that. And we've collected some smaller remnant data as well from there. So it's a random selection of households. So basically they went to each village and selected 60 households from each village that had a child under, at least one child under 24 months of age, so 2 years of age, at the time the study started, so in 2014. There's lots of data collection, which is really useful for me. They have the mother and child health and nutrition, which happens twice a year, which includes measuring the children, collecting height and weight, and arm circumference. There's a livelihood questionnaire, so looking at livestock numbers, different farming practices, where money's coming from, how big the household is, and also a 2-weekly data, which how many within these households, how many chickens they have every 2 weeks. So we can look at the dynamics of chickens populations throughout the year. And also they're looking at children health, child health and that. So number of episodes of diarrhea, any episodes of fever, whether they've had any supplementation of iron or vitamins, and whether they've been sleeping under a bed net. It's also a visual diary. So we've got data on 3 months out of the year spread out. So every 4 months they collect 1 month of data. And every week they record how many chickens have been bought, how many have been sold, how many have died, how many have hatched, how many have been gifted, and how many have been eaten of the different categories. So you've got chicks, growers, so chicks are up to 2 months of age, growers up to 5 months, and then adults, male and female adults, as well as eggs. The other data they collected is if there's any pregnant women or breastfeeding women, and the child that's registered in this larger study, how many eggs they've eaten in the week and how many times they've eaten chicken in the week. So they collected data on the child. So this is the model conceptualization. We've got 60 households still registered, although it does fluctuate throughout the year. Families come and go. And Chiche village is 59 because one has dropped out. Unfortunately, some of the children have died during this time. There has been a drought. But they've had more children, so they can be still registered if they've got a child under 2 years of age. So we conducted some focus group discussions and some structured interviews. Some of them were done during the mother and child surveys. So we had mother and children involved in the focus groups and discussions. We also had some groups of men just to see differences in how the model was perceived or how the system is perceived. And it helped us to understand a little bit some of the nuances in the data, because one of the problems we have, I haven't had access to the data for very long, but when we're looking at how the chicken numbers go week to week within one household, you might have 10 adults 1 week, and then the next week they record they have 30, and then it's down to zero, and it's hard to know exactly why that's happened. So just to sort of get a bit of an understanding of flock dynamics. And I also conducted a small ruminant study just to kind of supplement, have a different kind of concept of the livestock production systems, which I'll discuss a bit later. So these are just some photos of our conceptual models, which came out of the discussions, and interviewing one of the mothers during the mother and child surveys. So this is how I'm presenting. This is a sort of overview of the system. When you include all the different parameters, it gets really messy. So I just wanted to sort of give a broader view of how we've perceived the system. We have the poultry flock, which I've sort of discussed before. Coming out of that, we have, so some animals are kept to keep the flock the same size or sometimes increase the size. Some are consumed within the household, some are sold, some are given as gifts, and some will die. And home consumption and sale will affect the household food security. And then household food security is linked to child nutrition. So we're measuring two parts of child nutrition, so dietary indicators, which is sort of intermediary indicator to child nutrition. So we've measured egg consumption and chicken consumption from those visual diaries. We have dietary diversity scores, which come from the mother and child plus nutrition survey, and a little bit of what they actually consume. There's also data on breastfeeding and supplementary feeding in the young children, but I haven't as yet included those. They're sort of adjunct at this stage. And then we have nutrition indicators, so height for age, weight for age, length, and we have, they did some anemia and vitamin A testing in some of the villages, and we also have the circumference of the arm. So apparently middle upper arm circumference is quite consistent for the first 5 years of life, so it's a really good indicator of nutrition. And linking into the pathway, we're looking at intra-household dynamics. So decision making, size of the household obviously is really important. Who is the head of the household, whether it's male or female, and the social capital of that household. as well as time use and time allocation. So that will affect the links between household food security and child nutrition, as well as decisions about which birds are going to be consumed, how many, or who are sold, where the gifts go. And then the gifts obviously will affect social capital within the village. And so then we add into that Newcastle disease vaccination. So the aim is to decrease mortality. So if you decrease output into mortality, then you can increase the flows into the other compartments, and then a knock-on effect throughout the system. And then the final outcome we're looking at is the nutritional indicators of the children within that castle. So the different model components, we have the livestock population models, in this case the chicken. So we have initial populations of the chicks, which are up to 8 weeks of age. This is a weekly time model. We have growers, which go from 9 weeks to 22 weeks, and then the hens and cocks, so the male and female birds, older than 22 weeks of age. And then the eggs, which are within the household on a weekly basis. And I've actually maximised the flock size. So there's the flow which says we're going to keep some birds to keep increasing the size of the flock, but at some point the family makes this decision, actually we've got enough birds, and so we will sell them or keep them or consume them if that mortality flow is actually decreased because of Newcastle disease vaccine. That was kind of my subjective point in the system. We did ask some questions about what would you do if you had three more birds, and then what they would do with them, so whether they would eat them, keep them, or sell them, or gift them. And so we used that measured against how many chickens they had actually at that time, and tried to sort of get a feel for the sort of average number of birds at a maximum that people would be wanting to keep. The reason I did that was because otherwise we can't sort of proportion the different flows, and you would just mean that it won't have any effect. If you decrease mortality, it would just say proportion kept will stay the same as proportion sold, as proportion eaten, if that makes sense. So the poultry dynamics, chickens age, so eggs are kept for a certain point in time and then they hatch, and then they're chicks, so every week they get a week older. And then they turn into growers, and then after a number of weeks they turn into either hens or cocks. They kept maintain and increase the flock population. They're either purchased or sold. And they're either consumed at home, and they're either given as gifts or given to other people as gifts, and mortality. With the Newcastle disease vaccine, it is modelled here to decrease the all-cause mortality rate. So the initial model, I've used data from previously published studies, and then just recently I've tried to use the mortality rates that we've got from the data from the villages, which is not obviously as nice and easy number. And then when you're vaccinating and decreasing mortality, then you're increasing the actual number of birds present, and then affecting what you do with those birds. So within the household food security component of this model, we have data on the number of times eggs are consumed in the week and the number of times chicken is consumed in the week. And that links into the individual child model. So how many times does the actual child get to eat chicken or eggs if the household has them? And then the egg chicken and eggs, sorry, they're the dietary indicators. There's some that I've got there which we can potentially use, and I'd be really interested to see dietary diversity, because that would, I think, the income component of this model will affect dietary diversity more than home consumption. But I've yet to actually look at that data yet. And then for the nutrition indicators, we've got weight for age, weight for height, height for age and the middle upper arm circumference. And then again, there's some which I've sort of laid out a little bit, which we can potentially use, but the data there is not available yet. So whether it will be in the next couple of weeks, if I'm really lucky, and whether I then have time to look at it. So the model itself, as I was saying, we have weekly time steps. So the stocks and the, will change every week. And some of the flows will as well, which will sort of be seasonal flows, or because the vaccine's happening every three times a year, that'll affect mortality in the immediate period, and then we'll wane off. So the time, the flows and the stocks will change week to week. So just mentioned that there. And as I was saying before, I've decided on a maximum poultry size that a family would be willing to keep, and looked at a range. So I've said, okay, so first of all, we're going to say five hens, one cock, five growers, five chicks, and then see what happens if we kind of double that. What effect that has on the model. So we've got a range of different simulations for that. I've simulated the model for 10 years, but that there becomes a problem because we're looking at child nutrition. Up to 2 years of age. So the model simulates that once a child gets to two, miraculously another one's born. So you've always got one child within that 2 year age range. So yeah, I mean it's not definite reality, but actually there's quite a high birth rate. So we could say that it's not too crazy to probably have five kids in 10 years. And then the Newcastle disease vaccine comes three times a year, so that pulses within the model. I've also created a delay between the links, so if you eat chicken today, you're not automatically going to grow the same week. So there's a bit of delay, time delay, so increasing in egg consumption and chicken consumption, and hopefully dietary diversity will have a delay. So there's a couple. I've looked at month delay, but we can look at different delays within the system and what seems to fit the data better. And then I also was interested in what as a second model looking at small ruminants. So what's linked between small ruminant health within this farming or sort of rural community and child nutrition, again at household level. So we did questionnaires in the same villages using the same households, but only 30 of those households actually had sheep or goats. So we got 30 questionnaires out of the potentially 120. So we asked questions about ownership, so who in the household actually owns the animals, who makes decisions about them, animal husbandry, and we also ask questions about how often children consume meat from different categories of sheep and goats. And we also examined some of the animals themselves, so we tested 161 animals taking fecal samples, poo samples, from both sheep and goats. We looked at the Marcher score, which is a really simple way of looking at anemia, which there's one particular parasite in small ruminants that called a barber's pole worm, because basically it's full of blood, so it sucks blood from the gastrointestinal tract and looks like a barber's pole. So of course that can lead to anemia. So one way to see, a quick test to see if there's a problem in that area, is to do look at the conjunctiva of the sheep or the goat, and you have literally a colour chart, and you can say how anemic that is. And it's been tested a lot in the States, and actually it's quite a good correlation. So they could almost say if it's pale, you just go ahead and treat it without having to do anything else. And we also looked at body condition score, what's called a DAG score, so level of diarrhea in both sheep and goats. And then we took the fecal samples to a lab and counted the number of eggs per gram. where we can see parasite burden, and also cultured the larvae, and then identified what types of worms were there. So preliminary, I haven't sort of analysed the data in too much detail at the moment, but about 53% on average is the barber's paw worm, so it's quite high. And some of the worm burdens would be, you know, if it was in this country, you would automatically just treat it. So, and looking, going back to questions about animal husbandry, only two of the farms had treated with antibiotics or deworming treatment in the last year. One of them was clinical, so that's why they treated it. They were very, very pale, and the other one, he wasn't sure why they were treated. But they had, unfortunately that was the farm, we had a little hiccup at the lab, so we don't have very good results on fecal egg counts from that particular farm. It's a bit disappointing. So the idea is to simulate sustainable parasite control for that area. So what effect that might have on animal health and the mortality of the sheep and goats in that area, and then how that links with child nutrition again. So some of the results from the baseline model before we added in any Newcastle disease vaccine, there was a positive link between offtake rates within a household and the household food security indicators, which, you know, obviously makes sense. If you're going to have more for home consumption, then the household's actually going to consume more. And so even when there were low, when there were low home consumption rates, there were with higher flock numbers, so bigger flock size, there was actually more consumption of meat. So it's possible that they were selling the birds and then actually buying meat from elsewhere. So that's kind of the income pathway. And there was also a positive link between the household food security indicators and the child dietary indicators. That I divided the households into sizes, because obviously that has a big effect on what proportion the child has to eat with inside the household. So we had households of less than six. So the smallest household is going to be two, the mother and the child. But we didn't even have those. All the households within the survey had at least three, if not four people. But in the group which were less than six people, there was typically two adults and children, or sometimes one elderly person. There was a positive link. So to sort of demonstrate that if you've got a smaller household, then they're going to distribute food a bit more easily to the younger people. But then there was a weak link between these dietary indicators in the child itself and the nutrition indicators. So we'll look at perhaps why that's happening and whether there are other reasons why nutrition is low, for instance, poor health. So within the Newcastle disease vaccination simulation, I basically did the first simulation just saying, okay, we're going to decrease mortality by 80%, and then gradually build it up between the time waves of the vaccine. And that had a really good effect on the model on what was consumed inside the house. And because we were getting much higher consumption rates, actually, within that model, we were getting better child nutrition indicators. So it does say that perhaps it's not all to do with health, it's just to do with the low consumption levels to start off with. But within the data set itself, in 2015, the Newcastle disease didn't really have an effect on mortality rates from some of the data sets. And one of the big reasons for that was that there was a drought. So possibly that even decreased mortality from Newcastle disease, there were more birds and they were dying of vitamin A deficiency, which kind of fits with what the clinical signs people were describing the chickens had before they died.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
Is a vaccination, is that expensive?
Oh, sorry, yeah, I didn't even discuss that. Okay, so within Tanzania, it's at the moment, I think they're selling to the household at 200 Tanzanian shillings per vaccine, which at exchange rate is like 5-10 cents. And the way the system's working at the moment is that they have village vaccinators. Village vaccinators buy the vial of vaccine, and then the farmers kind of pay them back. So it's meant to help with sustainability of the system, because if it's given for free, then the thought is that that sort of chain, value chain, getting the vaccine from Dar es Salaam to the village, you know, won't continue once this project is finished. I have to get back to you on exact amounts. I can't remember my exchange rate at the moment. But it's within what people could afford if it's decreasing mortality. So it's, one of the key things with this is that actually we can do a quick cost-benefit or cost-effectiveness analysis, how much a family pays per Newcastle vaccine per year, to improvement on child nutrition indicators. So that's kind of a really quick and easy thing to do once this model's up and running and working well. So that's the idea. It literally takes seconds to do that. So yeah, there's some work in progress. At the moment I'm using, as I was saying, sort of discrete time variables. So averaging data out and then putting it in the model. But one way that you can use system dynamics is actually to use a data set that's time series. So I can look at these two weekly data sets and add them into the model. At the moment it's not working really well because the populations are going up and down. So I have to have some way of kind of averaging populations out so we're not getting crazy mortality and birth rates and death rates. I also want to include dietary diversity scores. And one thing I think would be really important here is the head of household. So to run the model as a male head of household or as a female headed household. When we're doing the focus groups, when we're asking who makes decisions about what to do with poultry, in the men's group it's all me, you know, blah, 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 blah. And in the women's group it's like, oh, it's a joint decision, you know, we do it together. So it depends on who you're asking the question to, but also when we're looking at the livelihood data, if we see if it's male-headed household, female-headed household, we can then relate that back to what data we've got. So I think that would be a really interesting component of the model. Also sensitivity analysis. So at the moment I'm just using discrete variables. So for instance, mortality rates of 20%. But what we can do, we can simulate and say, well, it's between 10 and 30, and what effect does that have on the model? So we can use distributions with all our parameters and see which parameters are most important for the outcome, which will be really good to actually see whether income pathway or sales and consumption, sorry, the home consumption pathway is kind of more important within these models. So some of the advantages of system dynamics of the methodology, it allows a time delay. So I've used this time delay between Newcastle disease vaccine and then going through the model, we can see what effect it has on child nutrition. We can pulse vaccination, so it's very dynamic. So if we're using purely statistical static models, we just say, what effect does vaccine have overall? Here we can say, you know, it's going to change. Changes as time changes. And also poultry mortality rates are not static, it depends on the seasons. So if we have lots of food around, we're going to have less chickens dying. And we can look at some of the intermediary parameters within the model. So as I was saying before, we can look at own consumption versus income effect within the model. And we can also simulate what if scenarios. So what if we have male-headed household, what if we have a female-headed We can also look, change the frequency and the timing of the vaccine. We say, well, at the moment we're vaccinating 3 times a year. Would it be better maybe to vaccinate 4 times a year? And we can also extend the model, which is where we come to after our limitations. So we had lots of, well, I have lots of data limitations, unfortunately. Definition of a household was a really big one. So when we went out and collected the small ruminant data, where we went to the and did the interview, how many goats do you have? 3. How many sheep do you have? 2. And then when we got to the farm, we collected 10 samples. And because one was happening during the day and one was happening either early in the morning or at night, it was hard to kind of link at the time until it wasn't until I got home and started plugging the data in and went, oh, that doesn't quite work. So I tried to link it back to some of the livelihood studies. But again, I think what's happened is that there's never, from all the the questionnaires, there's never really a definition of a household. So that could be one of the problems. I think we were taking family size samples or looking at family flocks compared to household flocks. So you might have a couple of brothers and sisters that put all their flocks together to house at night. So yeah, that might affect our analysis. And one of the other data limitations is the vaccine status of individual chickens or flocks, so at the household level, within these flocks that are registered, hasn't been recorded. So we only have number of households within the village that have been vaccinated, and these are enrolled or non-enrolled, so it's the village-wide basically. And that's why I've just put Newcastle disease vaccine given affecting mortality rates. So the vaccine is given at village level, the effect is at household level. And one of the model limitations, I omitted any climatic data. So some of the omitted variables affected the differences in intermittent. So that's probably why we may not be seeing great mortality reductions because of Newcastle disease. So climate, instead of being omitted, should probably be an exogenous variable. One of the other model limitations, at the moment it's independent of some of these household dynamics and broader farming systems. So we looked at cropping. And one of the other notable absences within the causal models, usually to child nutrition, is child health. So I haven't looked at the health status of the child. They're having diarrhea episodes, which obviously affects the ability to eat as well as the absorption of nutrients. So we need a more integrated model. So ideas for the future to include some environmental parameters. We can look at short-term cycles, so rainfall, temperature, and then long-term trends, because there was a drought in 2005, and then this wet season, it's actually been really lovely, to the fact that we couldn't cross between the two villages when we were trying to collect data. Broadening the farming system, so looking at some of the soil parameters, the cropping systems, what's used for forage, and the animal nutrition and feed availability, which I've sort of been discussing. And then, of course, the broader food market. I haven't looked at food prices, which was one of the 4 pathways. And so it would be really nice to have a look at how a market affects, especially when we were there, one day we were there, they had the local market. So people coming from Dodoma and Madeira, which are the two kind of bigger, Madeira, which are kind of bigger villages, a bigger town, sorry, surrounding, and what effect that can have. So when the market occurs and which will affect food prices. Some people can buy and sell grain or other types of food, so it should affect also dietary diversity. And including more about the intra-household dynamics. And then, as I was saying, child health indicators I haven't included, which I think should be really important. So veterinary use, fever, diarrhea, and some of the vitamin supplementation, which will have enough an effect. Nutrition. Okay, thank you for listening. Lots of people to thank. It's a really big project. Within Amana itself, I have three mentors because I'm quite lucky. So Jonathan is termed my home mentor, so from the Royal Veterinary College, and then Faraha in Tanzania is my host mentor. Robin Alders is the leader of the what we call the Nkuku for You project, but that's the poultry and crop integration project. Wendy's the team leader in Tanzania, and Julia is does everything. She's the main researcher for the project. Elpidius and Msafiri were basically helped me as translators and absolutely everything I needed to do. And then the rest of the team there and the staff at the Tanzanian Veterinary Laboratory Agency that helped me actually process the poo samples and analyze the results. Thank you.
So what kind of software do you use for the modeling? And also you mentioned that the model could be used the policymakers could use it. So is there a plan to make it somehow available that, in a simple form that they can use it as well?
Yes, is the short answer. So the first answer is at the moment I'm using Bensim software. It would be really nice to be able to use R, but I think within the year time frame and all I was trying to do, I didn't feel I had the time to kind of code from scratch. And we are looking for a second Amana grant to extend the project, and the idea then is to have a website with the model interface there. So we have the model running and people can kind of play with it. And within, for the Nkuku for You project, we're relating this data back to both the farmers or the farming families that are involved in the study, as well as the bigger community. Whenever there's meetings about the project, it's free for everyone to come along. So even if their children aren't enrolled, they can come and listen. So hopefully we're getting to a bigger diffusion within the villages for that. And because the project's actually linked with the Ministry of Health and the Ministry of Livestock and Fisheries, they're actually involved in longer term policies for animal health interventions. So yeah, there's kind of a direct link there. We sort of talk about the results at the country coordinating committee meetings as well as the project one, which includes Zambia.
That's an awesome question. I've got several. So I guess the first one is about the sort of the dynamics and relationships between the researchers and the participants, and kind of what, how. Because you were saying sometimes there are discrepancies in some of the data and it's quite complicated, and I work in social research, so I know how these things affect the data. So what was the sort of relationship between the researchers and the families, and kind of what was the incentives for them to be involved?
The incentive to be involved, they get mini incentives every time they bring their child to be weighed and measured in. So last time we gave them sort of a half a dozen eggs because we're trying to stimulate egg consumption, so that was a bit of a sneaky one, or little packets of seeds and things like that. So on a sort of small everyday basis, there's some incentive. Longer term, they're really hoping to improve education about nutrition. Within these villages, most children was actually, when I was just looking at the data yesterday, about 33% of the children had been given some other fluid within 3 days of birth. other than milk, and she was usually sugar water. So if and there's a nutrition component to this, so yeah, hopefully with that, with the crop component, they're doing field trials, so they're demonstrating simple things like just putting crops seed in rows, so it's easier to weed rather than scattering. So you can weed and water and at the end of the trial there was 6 times higher yield compared to the non-intervention crops. So hopefully there's instead because we can kind of demonstrate the benefits. There's a high risk because some of them are having to sort of record data every 2 weeks, get a bit boring. So yeah, I think that's probably why those results are a bit hidden miss actually, the 2 weekly data.
So that's kind of self-reporting?
They have what they call community assistance. So they've given a small payment per day that they actually work. So they actually go in and have their form and they just quickly record. So there's incentive for them to do it. It's hard to know whether the incentive is to do it correctly. you know, because it's the same with me. If someone said, yeah, report something every 2 weeks, oh, I forgot. Oh, you know, like that's human nature. You can't, you know, I wouldn't expect it to be any different. So, yeah.
And then in terms of, so you mentioned the kind of gender component and the dynamics there, and what I was just wondering if you could kind of just describe a bit more what they're kind of like there and what the kind of understanding is at the moment, how that affects things.
Yeah, so there's an anthropologist working on the project, and yeah, she's really kind of focused on gender. Whenever she's doing her groups, she's kind of splitting on gender as well as within the communities they sort of have these, you know, very poor up to very rich categories, and it's mainly based on livestock numbers. There's two linguistic groups which affects cultural dynamics and also gender dynamics there. I think it's like I think there is a level of gender violence there. There's gender violence everywhere, but during the mother and health survey, they were meant to bring their birth card as well as their project card, so we can kind of keep verifying ages and things like that. And there are a couple that said that they couldn't get in their house to get it. And seems to be quite high alcohol consumption, especially around the market days, and that's both sexes, same gender roles, which is quite high levels. So yeah, and it's extremely poor. There's no electricity there, so some people have solar panels, but it's not many. And it's only just recently the telecommunications towers got in, so they had no mobile network up to that point.
Yes, continue on that. So this sort of relationship you talk about, the kind of heads of household who make decisions and so on, and how like it. People would report differently depending on who you speak to. Kind of, were you able to get to the bottom of that at all? And kind of, how are you defining kind of head of household and how are they seeing it? And you know, did you kind of come to the conclusion actually generally the men are the ones who make the decision, or the men like to think they do, but actually it's this way around, or you know what?
Yeah, that's a really tricky one because I didn't have that much time to explore that. I think you'd need to be there for a long time to get real answers to that. One of the interesting things to come out was in one of the men's group, I was asking them who makes the decisions, and they, you know, were saying the, you know, blah, 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 blah. And I said, well, what happens if your wife or your partner salesman with chicken booth and asking, oh, I want beef. So, you know, that was kind of the first reaction, you know, and I tried to then explore it more, but the translator was, you know, he got embarrassed and didn't kind of want it. I said, no, this is, that's actually getting interesting. Come on, let's have dinner. And then, but some of the other men admitted, they said, well, if we don't include them in the decisions, then they can't be bothered feeding or looking after the chickens, so it doesn't help. So, yeah, it's got to be a choice. So I think some, you know, in my very, very subjective opinion, I think with poultry, actually, it probably is more a combined decision, but men don't like to admit it.
You know, it's seriously.
Yeah. Well, no, also that they're saying that, you know, I'm the head of household, I make all the decisions, whereas actually behind the scenes, it's not so. But that's, you know, I didn't quantify that, and really only just how I kind of perceived things when I was speaking to people.
First one, how did you jump from the household level to the individual level in the moment? The other one which is related is, because you have food security indicators, and it's more only the access component of food security. But then, that's a household level. How did you jump to the kid level? Because it's quite likely that it's not evenly distributed.
So
the units, guidelines.
So we had household level consumption data, so how many are consumed within the house, and then we have data on consumption for the mothers pregnant or breastfeeding and the children. So it's sort of two separate, and the way I kind of tried to link it is it's sort of proportional, which is not necessarily. So, and that's why we split it a bit into household size to try and break that down as a kind of confounding factor in there. But it's, yeah, definitely not ideal. I don't think there's a direct link. And that's why I think looking more at other household dynamics, so who makes the decision about what the child eats, or how much the mother's actually working, so is it the grandmother looking after? I don't know if that answers your question at all. I think that, you know, that's why I sort of tried to break it down into household food security as quite separate from the child consumption data and nutrition.
Can I just ask, I'm not very familiar with the systems dynamic modeling. Mm-hmm. What other sorts of applications in nutrition or agriculture for nutrition or agriculture for health do you think this would be an appropriate sort of model for?
I think you could look at broader food systems. So looking at agricultural value chains and how that affects. You can also look at different levels. I've looked at household level, but we could look at village level or even kind of more district level, which would capture some of the value chain components a bit more. And I would be really interested to see how we could look at it more for urban households where, you know, they don't have the agriculture within the household. It's more about a different kind of food available.
Do you need to have time series data really to sort of use it or not necessarily?
No, not necessarily. Yeah, I mean, basically, even if you just had same values with all your parameters and then you simulate it over time, there will be some dynamics because. For instance, you know, every time a bird dies or is born, it will change the population through the model. So yeah, no, you don't need time series data at all.
But you need some historic data, then, because otherwise you can't.
You need some, otherwise you're just making it up. But yeah, you do need to be able to, you have some data to actually quantify the model. Otherwise, it's a qualitative sort of conceptual model, which is absolutely, you know, fine in itself. And I think yeah, when you see a lot of the sort of the pathway models, there's very little actually at household level pathways. They're more kind of looking at policies or kind of broader links. So I was really interested in what's actually happening in the household. Yeah.
I was wondering whether you could expand on how you're going to look at the breastfeeding data in the model, and if you've got kind of any idea of what breeding practices are like in that area, and also whether it would be useful bringing in mother's consumption patterns for the very, because obviously they're very young children, too, so whether it's worth including that as well as the children.
Yeah, so there is data on pregnant and breastfeeding mothers available. I kind of ran out of time.
Yeah.
That's absolutely, would be a really good indicator, and I think, I've just focused on child nutrition because we've got to condense what I'm doing. So that's, and with in terms of looking at the breastfeeding, I was looking at more, because another component of this model I actually haven't included is looking at nutrition education, which is a component of the bigger project. So once they start doing their nutrition education intervention, you could add that as another component in the model and what effect that has on breastfeeding. And linking it. So
you have an idea up to what age they start, introducing solids and that kind of.
Yeah, so that data is in there because they do ask questions about the first time the child had anything other than milk.
Yeah.
And then the first time I had solid or semi-solid food,
mm-hmm.
and it's really young, really
yeah.
young. Like it's, first of all, as I was saying, within 3 days of birth, they
yeah.
have sugary water, and I don't think that's good. and then in terms of complementary feeding, is actually very young again, and it seems to be about 3 months of age. In an area where you don't have running water, so
yeah.
And do you know how long they keep breastfeeding for, even if they're kind of introducing other foods from a very young age, do they still continue breastfeeding for a long time?
I couldn't tell you, I'd be making it up, but again, that they do ask questions about that, so yeah. It's because it's such a big project, there's quite a few different PhD students and master's students working on the data. So they're analysing different components, and one of them is looking at breastfeeding and complementary feeding. That data should be kind of, or that analysis should be really available, I think, the end of this year, probably. It would be super interesting, but I haven't kind of included it at this point.
And what's the sort of feature of this? There's obviously lots of people involved, different components and so on, and then you mentioned that you're kind of trying to get further amount of funding.
So
for you to keep working on it, or?
Yeah, so we're interested in see whether we can get funded a more social ecological model, so including more environmental parameters and more intra-household dynamic parameters, so sort of extending and broadening the model, which would be really good because I've kind of got to a point where I feel like we could do something with it. So it's kind of proof of concept that it is a possibility. So we'll have to wait and see that one. And if not, I was speaking to Jonathan about, other kind of funding possibilities. Because it would be good to kind of continue.
Yeah, so it's data that would be.
Yeah, huge amount of data. It's so exciting. My data nerd came out.
Yeah.